My topic will be handler socket plugin for MySQL. And my name is Hedong Ji. I work for Percona. And this presentation actually is me and my colleague Ryan Lowe, who's sitting in the back. We work together on that. And we welcome your questions and input. But without further ado, let's get started. And before I get started, just want to make sure that a few items I would mention. And if you have a cell phone, please silence that. And also, during the course of the presentation, please do feel free to ask questions. And by all means, please do. I'm not going to pretend to be a Mr. Know-it-all, but at least I will try to point you to the right direction. But at the same time, if you guys have experience to your fellow participants' question, please feel free to chime in as well, because is this not, I hope this is going to be an interactive session. I want to learn from you as well. So just want to get that out of the way, and let's get started. So MySQL, the handler socket is the basically a NoSQL interface to MySQL. And NoSQL has been in the marketplace for the last 2 or 3 years. Basically, it came because of the need of the explosion of social networking and web 2.0. Facebook, LinkedIn, and mobile devices. There are a lot of usage that user case where people need to do a quick key value pair lookup. And to answer that need, we have in the industry, we have Memcached, we have Gearman, we have Cassandra, Redis, Amazon Dynamo, and things like that. Those technologies are designed to face the challenge of explosion of social networking and the volume of data, so that they put intermediate caching layer in between, and also can do a quick key value lookup. So that's why this movement of NoSQL, some people say NoSQL is kind of acronym for bypass all SQL or SQL Server or MySQL Server altogether. The other people say, hey, it's not only SQL. But in any case, a lot of this usage came out of the situation that I just want to do a quick key value lookup. And this handler socket is designed for that purpose. So let me delve into the handler socket architecture. I should also say that I will not be doing too much talking, because I do not want to be talking head, but these kind of architecture is important to understand. We're going to do demos later on. So the I mentioned that the NoSQL solution like Cassandra, like Memcached and stuff are good for key value pair lookup. And the reason that they are good at that is that they're caching a lot of stuff, and sometimes they have their own specific data store. But the challenge with MySQL is that in many cases, the CPU usage for MySQL listener and also the query parsing and execution plan generating actually takes a lot of CPU time. So the idea behind a handler socket is that it is MySQL specific, it is InnoDB specific. Because we know MySQL, because we know the InnoDB storage engine interface, and we know the table structure, which is based off of primary key and its corresponding values, we can bypass the query processing, the parsing, listening, and the execution plan generating part, and just talk to the database storage engine, in this case, InnoDB directly. That's the idea of the whole handler socket architecture. It just bypasses all those intermediate processing, and therefore speed up the process. We have done a lot of testing. A lot of people have done a lot of testing using OProfile, and so on and so forth. This is just a follow-up to the previous architecture extension of that architecture design, is that late MySQL consumes a lot of CPU time, and this is especially important in today's age because a lot of the servers and a lot of companies have a huge amount of RAM, and you can suck in all the data inside the RAM or cache. Therefore, the CPU usage and the waste your time on CPU becomes an acute problem. And with handler socket, we can just bypass that part and trim off those extra CPU usage and talk to the database engine storage engine directly. The reason we can do that is that we know the InnoDB storage architecture, we know the table architecture because it's based on the key value pair, those kind of schema design, therefore can bypass that altogether and trim those CPU usage time off and improve the overall system performance. Like I said, because the huge amount of memory and the caching that we can do, I/O in some cases is not a bottleneck anymore. Well, in the cases where you can dump everything inside the memory, therefore it's important to trim the CPU part. So this is a result of old profile where it lists all where the MySQL spends its time. As you can see, the MySQL parse on the left hand side, you can the MySQL parse, the join operation, the lexicon, the lex underscore one token, all of these processes are just a MySQL instance spinning its wheels, try to parsing all those SQL statements and generates the query execution plan, and so on and so forth, before it talks to the storage engine InnoDB underneath. Whereas the handler socket, the CPU usage in most cases happens in the kernel side because it just bypasses all those extra processing. It also, MySQL, the handler socket also does a logging behind the scenes so that it's easier for troubleshooting and for verification purposes. However, because it does not go through the query processing part, therefore it would not write to the slow query log or general query log. However, it does create the role-based replication events inside the binary log, and it will also write to the error log, which I will demo to you later on when we reach that part. And well, I sort of I'm going quick because at the same time we probably want to get out earlier to get an early start on lunch. but I want to skip minus and I will get to the demo part really quickly. This is sort of a rehash of what we discussed earlier. Where does it fit? It fits into the situation where you use MySQL, you use InnoDB as your storage engine, and you need quick, fast, key value lookup. So, why use handler socket versus the other NoSQL solution? Handler socket actually provides a lot of create, the CRUD statements like DML, insert, update, delete, select. And not only that, it actually is easier to set up than Memcached, than Cassandra, and other NoSQL solutions because it is bundled with a lot of MySQL distribution nowadays. For instance, Proponent 5.5, which we bundled handler socket within, so you do not have to do your separate compilation, build, make, build, config, and all that stuff. So therefore, it makes it actually easier to set it up and use it. In other words, getting it up and running will be much faster than if you go take the Memcached or Cassandra route. So that's where it fits into your overall architecture design and usage. The current challenges is that it's still relatively new. It came to the marketplace maybe in November last year. I think it's already been in Japan. The DNA company, where Ishinori actually blog about it. to address this specific challenge.
And
the modules and libraries are slow to catching up, but they are catching up now. In fact, in my demo, I'm going to do a Python library demo for you guys in a few minutes. The challenge that I have met is that also the lack of documentation that makes it hard to hack and to read, to understand the architecture. But, you know, and also there are bugs, of course. And but hopefully we are sessions like this and also blog articles that we will, is going to help to change that. And that's the purpose of this presentation. And before we dive into the demo, let me also talk about some drawbacks of Panther socket. The drawback is that currently there are no insecure authentication because it opens a port. You know, by default, we can do 9999 and 9998, which we will demo later on. So as long as you have a telnet session, you can have access to that port. But that can be enhanced by you know, IP table firewall rules that you can say, hey, I want to only these specific hosts and clients like this to have access to this particular port on my MySQL server. There's also the access control is not granular enough. So if you open up access to a InnoDB table, inside MySQL, you can say, hey, I want to do the more granular column level or table level control of tables inside one of my InnoDB databases. But the in the case of Panther socket, it's all or nothing. And but you know, things are constantly being developed and addressed. In fact, my colleague Ryan wrote something about how to do authentication with password and login and stuff, which is still clear text, but it's sort of insecure authentication. It's better than nothing. It's a good starting point. I alluded to this part earlier. There are two ways of getting Panther socket up and running. One is that you can get a distro which has this thing compiled and built in. In our case, you can go to Yum, Pocona Yum repository, or our Debian-based APT repository, and install those packages, and then it's just a matter of enabling it. You inside my.cnf, and then register this plugin. The other way is to, you can download the source code yourself. You need the Panther socket source code itself. You also need MySQL source code because it needs those header files and stuff for it to compile. And once those SO files, the shared object library files, are being compiled, you can put them into your MySQL plugin directory and then register that. That's more involved, more manual process, but it can be done and it has been done. Now, my talk is almost over. Let's go ahead and get to the demo part. Any questions so far? Okay.
So, I have one question.
Yeah.
That Yum repository that you've set up, and then would you consider that a distro that is production quality, or would you say?
Oh, yes, it is. Yeah, it has been used. It certainly is production quality because the Pocona server, Yum repository, the Pocona 5.1 and 5.5 is widely used by people.
Okay.
Yeah. But the only thing is that I want to say is that Panther socket use, the usage of Panther socket is still not widely spread. But hopefully things like this will help its adoption. Okay, so what I have done, my setup is that I actually have created a virtual server from Rackspace Cloud Server, so I'm going to remote into that server and do all the setup and processing there. So, bear with me 1 second. I need to go to my folder.
Yeah, I'm a Fedora fan, so I'm not very used to the Ubuntu.
Now that I can put an SE this here.
Root at this server. Okay, that's where it is. So at this point, let me show you, start off by logging into your MySQL.
Let's run a command called show plugins.
I didn't remove it, but let me go ahead and remove it. Uninstall Kotlin. So this, there are 35 rows.
Okay.
Can you guys see the edge? There are 35 rows in this this plugin, meaning that there are 35 plugins by default being compiled. And as you can see that 100 is not there. Let me jump into a different session. And SSH root. IP address. Password. Love that video clip. It's fantastic. Yes, I'm in. So, so the first step you want to do is that you want to put in the configuration settings inside the MyConf file. So let me go ahead and demo that. I've done that beforehand. Easy, MySQL, MyConf, Flash. And then set IC, case insensitive, and then search for under. These part, the six lines, are the ones that I added in myself. So in other words, I just did a generic vanilla Pomona server install, and afterwards I put in those additional handler socket specific configuration settings. You know, the root handler support 9998, that's for read only, a support that you can connect to do the reading. And then the one afterwards is next to it is port WR read and write 9999. And then I enable 16 read threads, the maximum 16 read only threads. And then I enable the read and write threads, but it's only one. And finally, the 500 is 65,000 also. So this is a minimum setting that you need to get 100 sockets started. All the rest is just the generic vanilla stuff I can customize. So let me go ahead, get out of here, and let me also show you that if I do go to telnet session, because I set up those 9999 and 9998 port, and if it's open, I should be able to telnet to it. Localhost 9999. No, it's not there yet. Why? Because we don't have that plugin enabled at this point. So let's go ahead and enable that plugin. Let's do install. Install plugin. By the way, it has to be called handler socket. If you do, just for kids, install junk. SO name. Can't find single junk library, which is not surprising. So, to So now, if we do show plugins, notice there are 36 rows now, and that very last one is the handler socket. It's a daemon, it's a service, and also this one is not null, meaning that this is not this is you can register afterwards. For the ones with an null column, the library you cannot disable. It comes with the system. For this one, with the library. With a non-null value inside the library column, you can add register. And okay, interestingly, it's a BSD license, whatever that is. Now it is in and registered. What do you want to do then? Is that you want to go ahead and restart the service? Let's see, service, MySQL, restart. And let's go ahead and take a look at the error file. And let me do case insensitive, and let me do hamburger. And I'm going to do uppercase N to search the very last item. So we can see handler socket initialized. So, like I mentioned earlier, this is consistent with what we discussed earlier, the logging part. It does log into this error log file, which is a very good way of troubleshooting our verification purposes. So let me get out of the main session. And let's try our telnet session this time. Do you notice the difference here? Now, I am able to telnet into this port because I have done three things up to four things actually. I have done insert those four or five configuration settings into the my.cif file. I have registered into the this plugin into the system. Remember the show plugins results. I have did the telnet session, I verified the error log file and it's being initialized. It is now up and running. Now that we know that it's up and running, let me go ahead and do the general explanation on how this thing is used. So I have a Python file called a hansel.dump. So this, I just want to start off with that. That hey, how do I get data? So this is a quick test of that. Let me go ahead and explain, open that up. You know, handler socket, I just call it hand solo. It's actually, you know, actually match. Hand solo, handler socket. I was pretty happy with that. I'm sure they're not, you know, did that on purpose, but it just, by coincidence. What do you need is that you need the TYHS library, which you can get by using easy install to get the library, or you can compile it yourself. Don't worry about it because all in my slides and in my blog post, I do have instructions on how to get that. So you get that library, and then you say, hey, this is the database I'm interested in, a test, and this is a table that I'm interested in. The first one is a key column that I'm interested in, and based off of that, I will be able to get all of the key values here. So before we do that, let me just show you what the data looks like in T1. Select from T1. So I have, you know, a bunch of very intelligent values there, 1, 1, 2, 2, 3, 4, so on and so forth. Now, if I go to, if I go ahead and execute this, you know, how many lines? 9-line sort of code. So if I do Python, I'm solo dump.
No point in editing. Okay. So this is how you can use it. This actually presents the data in a format, in a Python dictionary, you can easily translate into JSON or whatever. So this is how you can use it. Now it comes to the speed part. Now I want to do a demo on the performance comparison between a Pandora socket library versus a program that uses MySQL client library that does not use Pandora socket. So that those things will take you know 1 minute or so to each one. So let me kick that off. Before I explain to you, so let me go ahead and do this. Python, handsolo.py, and let's go ahead and run that. And up here, I can show you. It's gonna do show tables. So this time, it's actually gonna look at this customer table. This customer table is built with the TPC-H benchmark tool. It has 150,000. Records in it, and it has a generic customer table with customer ID, customer name, customer address, and stuff. It's very, very similar to a lot of social networking and web tools sort of application that I do a quick lookup. I want to know this customer. I know his likes and his gender, his age, and then I do something about it. So this is the customer table that we're dealing with. And while that thing is running on the other side, let me explain to you my test. So once again, I do a little timer, I import the data, and I know that I have 150,000 number of rows in it. So in my case, I just want to say, hey, in 1 minute, in 1 minute of time, how many records can I process? So I, in this case, is a primary key, because I is a customer ID. And with this, I'm going to say get customer key, get customer name, and get customer address based on I. And this I will increment by one in every single loop. And if within 1 minute of time it reaches 150,000, I will tell it to start over from one again. And this is how I let it run for 60 seconds. I get the timer, get the time module, and then I do the get a start time, and then do the minus. When it's over 60 seconds, I say great. I want to say that. Get me out of here. I want to see how many records I process. So here we're done. Says using the handler socket below is a report of how many customers' name and address can be retrieved based on the customer key. Seconds elapsed is 61 seconds, more or less. And row retrieved is 475721. So let me go ahead and start the regular generic processing where you are not using handler socket. You have to go through the MySQL client library. You have to go through the processing of MySQL, listening to those libraries, listening to those requests, gather the requests, go through those parsing, query execution and generating part, and that part I call it mClient. Let me kick it off and then I'll show you how it looks like. So this is the HandSolo Pandora socket. And let's take a look of mClient. In this case, I'm using MySQL DB, which is a library that using uselib, MySQLH, and things like that. And I also present things in a dictionary format. Excuse me. I may have to start speaking Chinese. My English is off. So this also presents data back in a dictionary format. You can transfer into JSON or whatever format you want to use. And this does the generic as you can see, select same customer key, CNAME, CAddress from this particular table. And the logic is the same, is that, hey, if you can finish that 150,000 records in within 1 minute, start from one again. So let's see how many records you can process within 1 minute time. Yes, sir?
Can you run top over the benchmark you're running?
You can, you can. Actually, I have done that in the past, but right now it's probably truly enough. But that old profile that we showed earlier, we basically showed the same thing that we lost. But it's going to be a very good exercise just to, you know, to go back to do that. I may not even have time to do that. But that's a good, very good point. You want to do top or old profile? And let's go ahead and look at the results. So this one using MySQL client libraries, and it 253 something, basically 254, give or take. So as you can see, this actually the performance improvement is fairly phenomenal. It's not 50%, but close to. You know, the number of records that it retrieves using Hamburger Socket, it almost doubles. Well, not quite, but it's quite impressive.
So, sir, is this running on your laptop or somewhere
else? This is running somewhere else. This is a Rackspace cloud server.
How big is the data set there?
How big
Maybe
is
we just simply get it from the memory.
No, it's not. That's a very good question. And that's essentially what I did.
Because in order to prove this test, we should have the size of the data set like 5 times more than the memory.
Oh, yes. The memory that I got is only 1 gig of memory on this particular server.
Uh-huh.
And then I have 150,000 rows. I think it's 4 or 5 gig or something like that.
So
the answer is yes. It's not, it cannot fit in the memory.
From the blog that which you know about this,
yes.
Seems like if you have an in memory games,
Right. That's
because then my experience itself is pretty much.
Right. That's exactly what I mentioned earlier. Is that when it's in memory, then the CPU time, the CPU time wasted is not a huge problem. And this one get rid of the CPU usage.
This is still a good improvement.
Yeah, this is still a good improvement. This one, you know, so regardless of if you are getting it from the disk or from the cache from the memory, it's going to be faster than this because even if when it's in memory, especially when it's in memory, the CPU usage waste becomes an acute problem because at that time, your disk I/O, you kind of isolate disk I/O out of the picture, and then at that time, the CPU becomes a problem.
When you mentioned memory, is it like pure data or encrypted or compressed data?
I'm talking about pure data. Nothing is compressed. Nothing is compressed and nothing is encrypted. It's generic in the YSQL storage. Yes?
Do you tend to see similar gains across higher concurrent workloads?
Have I tested high concurrent workloads?
Are the gains the same?
I'm not too sure, but the scalability may be different, but the improvement should definitely be there. Yes.
Yeah. So theoretically, it'd be a lot better running Hamburger Socket than any MySQL. MySQL is one vertical connection. So you have 10,000 over connections, you have 10,000 threads running. Basically, nothing. Well, this is going to pull threads. So you're just going to have something not running. So you have latency.
The creators of this, I think, also are awesome.
Yes. Yeah, you should know.
He's not here.
No, he's not in this session.
Trying to find Yoshinori.
Yeah, he's around. I saw him earlier. Yes.
But do you have, in general, do you have the performance data for, like, typical size of the row? I don't know, maybe 20, 40 bytes per compute name value? and number of the connections and latency, like some graphs?
Yes, I have not produced the graphs myself, but you should know actually he has in our blog post, he has more benchmarking and comparison, which is in my slide resources. Basically, what he, if I understand him correctly, he his results prove that actually it's faster than so yes, that benchmarking has been done.
It's 7 times. Yeah, not the famous thing actually against MySQL. The benchmark where you have multiple clients.
And it's done on the deep data set?
Yeah,
with
yeah
the
no,
with
in,
the
in memory data.
How well would the data set be bigger than the memory set?
And that's the test that I did.
This piece is probably
yeah.
This is still secret dependent, but this is probably
It does provide me with some idea. Yeah.
How familiar is it with GTFE? Is it my, I mean I see that it's tapped in when you're talking to the board, for example.
Oh, when you are doing the telnet, you are doing it. I don't think it has any drawback on GTFE because it's just getting the values. My field client is getting the values from the storage engine, and so is Hamlet's on it. There's no bearing on that.
And I think the protocol is such that the next part is. So the protocol is tabular and limited that you have. You know, you have some common and then whatever the record contains is just at the end. So but actually I don't know how it's because you can also fetch one of the records.
Yeah.
It's still a valid question.
Yeah, I don't know.
I think the difference should be probably if you're talking about GTFE, the size of the number of bytes and figures are probably similar to the test with the longer attribute name, 20 bytes versus 4 bytes.
Yeah.
That's my
understanding. It's just the attribute
names. Do you support the attribute name in GTFE?
I haven't tested it myself, but I don't see why not.
Same, this is the same
question. GTFE, pardon me?
I don't think so. I think it should be the value maybe.
Yes, right.
It works. I can tell you it does work.
Oh, 1 more minute. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
But, I would bet on it. That would be my money on it.
Okay.
Simple test might work. Actually, it might work. As in whole name similar or facelift. Yeah.
But anyway. So that's sort of the test case that we did. This is a test data we created earlier, and the protocol. We did the telnet stuff. One good way of doing that is just telnet to that port and see if it's successful. If it is, then it is up and running. If it's not, then it's not running yet. So like I mentioned earlier, a lot of the client libraries have been developed, Coral, PHP, Java, Python, which I demonstrated. And we've done those kind of stuff. I believe actually my colleague Ryan wrote those check MySQL on the Nagios plugin, and this can be monitored. And cacti monitoring for Hamlet socket has been requested. And the other map kit and the instrumentation for PHP, these are all in development. So
it does provide a lot of performance enhancement, and things are ongoing, and I certainly see value of using that in the in environments. Yeah.
I think there's some questions if you look at a couple of minutes. You didn't mention the cluster, or is it the same or clustering for NoSQL based on MySQL? Clustering for NoSQL based on MySQL is pretty similar as just regular MySQL. If I want to run the cluster, is it replication or something like this?
Are you talking about MDB cluster, or are you talking about...
No, I want to run the solution as a cluster. Is it just regular MySQL cluster?
There are two different products.
So you can use MySQL interview based on it, and MySQL. And then I think this works.
Oh yeah,
right.
Yes. Yes.
It's a sure. Yeah. So.
Yeah. So these are some resources that you can go ahead to develop, and I will put in all my sample Python libraries. In that computer, and I was told that it will be automatically uploaded to the conference website. You guys have been asking me questions, but to recap, before I call it a day, it's useful if you are using MySQL, if you're using MDB storage engine, and it's easier to set up. Much easier than MapHD or other NoSQL solutions, because if you get the component, or I'm not too sure about other tools, but it's baked in. You do not need to do extra work other than the one that I mentioned earlier. So that's what I got, and thank you very much for attending, and enjoy the lunch. And if you have questions, feel free to ask and stick around and email. So thanks a lot.